Perfect. Thank you. Jayantha, one of the other developments since the Fukushima accident was the June 2011 decision of the Nuclear Suppliers Group to adopt more restrictive criteria which nuclear technology exporting countries should use to decide what nations can acquire sensitive nuclear technology. Can you briefly outline those criteria, explain how world governments are reacting to this? For example, is this considered a violation of the Article 4 commitment of the NPT that countries have the right to acquire nuclear technology? And will efforts to sign civilian nuclear agreements with India complicate this matter more?
Well, Scott, a broad swath of countries in the global south belonging to the non-aligned movement who have no nuclear ambitions, nuclear weapon ambitions, but who want nuclear power for peaceful uses in the service of the development of their countries, do see the Nuclear Suppliers Group as a self-appointed cartel who have decided on guidelines without consultation with them to effectively prevent the export of dual-use technology. Now, the Nuclear Suppliers Group goes back to about 1974 and had, first of all, the Zanger list, the trigger list, which, if was applied for, would indicate ambitions which a country had to become a nuclear weapon state. And, of course, that would have to be treated very cautiously. Secondly, there was another list called the dual-use list, which, again, had to be approached very cautiously if there were applications for exports of those kind of components, which could have led to a nuclear weapon program. Now, what happened in June of this year at a meeting of the Nuclear Suppliers Group, which has now grown to 46 and includes developing countries like Brazil and Argentina, and also includes China, which for a long time had kept away from the NSG, they met in the Netherlands and they approved a revised set of guidelines for exports relating to uranium enrichment and spent fuel pre-processing and technology. The new rules effectively bar exports to states that have not signed or are not in compliance with the NPT. They do not, or states which are not allowing comprehensive IAEA safeguards, and also don't allow extensive monitoring under the terms of the additional protocol, among the other criteria. The statement that was issued after this meeting was very brief. It did not explicitly give the new guidelines, but it agreed to strengthen the guidelines on the transfer of sensitive enrichment and reprocessing technologies, ENR. It talked about the Brasilia plenary decision to review the status of adherence to the additional protocol and went on to make several other points. But it was only in July, in a communication from the president of the group to the IAEA, that we had a spelling out of these amendments. And they consisted of a change in paragraph 6 and 7 of the guidelines. And paragraph 6 had special controls on sensitive exports and talked about exercising a policy of restraint in the transfer of sensitive facilities, equipment, technology and material usable for nuclear weapons or other nuclear explosive devices, and went on to give specific cases, and I won't go into all the details, but again, the NPT question is repeated, the IAEA safeguards issue and other conditions are explicitly stated, including the provision of the additional protocol. In Chapter 7, what they do is they give details of what exemptions can be made, and exemptions are made with regard to cooperative enrichment enterprises, and that included the agreement between Brazil and Argentina on BAC. Now, the commentary on it, of course, noted of that whereas in the past there were the members of the NSG were only asked to exercise restraint in the export of sensitive technology, much more specific conditions had been laid down in the revised guideline. And this included the fact that objective criteria had been established, which had not been there before. And of course, the reference to an additional protocol of the IAEA as a condition of supply is a new requirement. And that is very controversial because, as you know, joining the additional protocol of the IAEA is entirely voluntary, and there are some countries who balk at joining the additional protocol because they feel very strongly that as long as Article 6, which is the disarmament article in the NPT, is not being completely fulfilled by the nuclear weapon states, there is no justification for imposing further burdens and controls on the non-nuclear weapon states. But the exemption made for the EBAC arrangements, of course, also are questionable because there were some who thought that the level of assurance about a country's nuclear program was not the same under the EBAC as it is under the additional protocol. Now, the fact of the matter is that these guidelines are another perceived as another burden on the non-nuclear weapon states, and their basic approach to the nuclear suppliers group in general is, as I said, that of a self-appointed cartel. And the question that would be asked, of course, is if, for example, OPEC, the oil petroleum organization of petroleum exporting countries, impose some guidelines with regard to the purchase of oil, requiring purchasing countries to contribute 1% of their GDP for the Millennium Development Goals or something like that, that would be seen as being irksome. Now, you could say, of course, nuclear weapon component export are different because they are weapons of mass destruction. But then the developing countries see the same controls in conventional weapons with the Wassenaar arrangement, with the missile technology control regime, and so on. And so these are seen as being not mutually cooperative arrangements. If they were a result of consultation between the importing countries and the exporting countries, some consensus could be reached. And that is why I think the new guidelines will be seen as an additional burden and an additional limitation on the development of these countries, which can be undertaken freely. On India, that issue is a completely different one because it stems from the very controversial US-India nuclear cooperation agreement, which was widely seen, including by non-aligned countries who have friendly relations with India, as being a violation of the NPT and as being inconsistent with the UN Security Council Resolution 1172, which had very harsh language with regard to both India and Pakistan on the explosion of nuclear devices in 1998. And then to have a complete somersault and have this country, which was outside of the NPT, embraced and given the facilities normally reserved for countries who are in good standing as non-nuclear weapon states in the NPT, was seen as a betrayal of the NPT. That was done, of course, and then the NSG was persuaded as a result of U.S. aggressive diplomacy to accept the nuclear cooperation agreement and to waive the guidelines, and it was seen as a clean exemption, although the question of ENR was not specifically referred to at that time. The Indians now feel the June guidelines do not apply to them. And there is a big controversy which has still not been clarified as to whether, in fact, the June guidelines will be applicable to India or not. A number of people who have read, of course, the US legislation on the subject, including the Hyde Act, feel very clearly that ENR is certainly not going to be given to the Indians, but the Indian press comment and the official comment from the foreign minister as well as others makes it very clear that their understanding is that the clean exemption included exemption for ENR technology. So that issue remains undecided.
Thank you very much.